Hi everyone, welcome to Night School. I'm Lynn.
And I'm Aria. Really briefly, some of you regulars may not notice that I am not Christina, but I'm just filling in for her while she's away. But yeah, welcome.
I was gonna mention that too, if you weren't going to. hi everyone, we are part of the Nightlife Night School team at Cal Academy in San Francisco. Nightlife is our weekly Thursday night events where we mix science with cocktails, live music, and more. We have been back at the Academy for, like a month plus now. And some fun news is that starting next week, Nightlife will actually be returning to our weekly events. So we'll be back in the building every week. If you're around, please come by. It's both sad news and good news because this actually means Night School is going to be moving to monthly. So for those who are new to Night School is our virtual version where we're sending a little bit of Nightlife back home to you. And we announced this last week, but we are officially moving to once a month on first Thursdays. So please make notes in your calendar, set reminders, subscribe, all the things. But yeah, that's just a quick update. And tonight's theme is inspired by one of our current exhibits, Color of Life. And it's all about color, surprise, and how it plays a part in the natural world.
Yeah, so today, as always, we have some brilliant scientists here to talk about color in a lot of different forms, a lot of different animals. So some folks you'll hear from are first Dr. Yusan Yang, a postdoc at Washington University in St. Louis, who will share about strawberry poison dart frogs and their vibrant colors. And she's worked with animals like these super cute frogs to also guppies, and actually studies how certain animal behaviors can ultimately influence ecology and evolution at these larger scales. Next, after that, you will hear from Erick Bayala, who is a PhD student at the University of Chicago, looking at how color develops in animals from the time that they're a single cell to when they're in their final form. And specifically, he's looking at how multiple genes work together to actually paint these like patterns that you see on butterfly wings. And finally, you will hear from Dr. Simon Griffith, who's a bird researcher currently based at Macquarie University in Australia, who will share today about a bird that has almost all of the colors of the rainbow, like very, very close to, and it's called a Gouldian finch. And these finches usually have heads that are either red, black, or yellow, and Dr. Griffith's work looks to understand why and how these colors evolve in birds and in general, evolve in birds, these specific species, and in general. So yeah, really amazing lineup tonight. Lots of different animals. You'll see a lot of pretty colors and cute frogs and beautiful species.
all the things. But then I just noticed, Aria, that me and you are not very colorful tonight, but.
Oh yeah, we are.
It's okay. We'll have colors. Here's my color. But we'll have a lot of color in the presentation. As always, tonight's program is live, mostly live. So say hi, let us know where you're watching from. We always love seeing if it's your first time or if you're a Night School regular. We see all the Night School regulars. So hi to everyone that we see every week. We'll have Q&As after Yusan and Eric's conversation. Just a note, Simon's is pre-recorded. I did a light Q&A and I am wearing a different shirt. So FYI, I'm not doing costume changes. But yes, we'll have Q&A. So get your questions in the chat or comment box. And with that, we will now pass it over to Yusan.
Hello, everyone. Hi from Missouri. And thanks, Aria, for that wonderful introduction. Lynn, can I have my slides up? All right, cool. Let's dive right into it. So thank you all so much for tuning in today. I'm so excited to be in this series because I've always been very fascinated by the different coloration of animals and how that they function in day-to-day life in all these animals and how they evolve in the first place. So today I will share a little bit of my research with you on specifically about how colors functions in both natural selection and sexual selection in these very fascinating strawberry poison dart frogs. All right, so diving right into the species. So this species is native from the Neotropics, distributed from Nicaragua, Costa Rica to Panama. And so the really cool thing about their coloration is that throughout most of the distribution range, they have this really iconic coloration of red body and blue limbs, so kind of like a Spider-Man costume. But if you zoom into this little area called the Bocas del Toro Archipelago, what you will actually see is this amazing array of coloration. So essentially in this archipelago, if you go on different islands or adjacent populations on the mainland, basically, you can see this wide array of coloration. So I'm actually kind of jealous about the finches stealing the rainbow on common. So because I'm going to say like in this frog, basically any color you can imagine, you can probably find a population with that coloration. So the cool thing about this is that these different color types or what we call color morphs, they are of the same species. So if you put two different colored frogs in captivity, they will still breed, they will produce offspring that are still fertile. So in biological species concept, they're still one species. So this presents us with a very cool opportunity to look at how these variable populations, variable colorations in different populations influence the day-to-day life of these frogs. So to know the function of these colorations in the frog's life, we need to dive a little bit into what these frogs are doing in their day-to-day life, right? So this is the life history of the frogs. So basically what they do to complete a life cycle. Starting from the adults, so the males in this species is territorial, meaning that the males occupy a location and then chase out other males that are trying to enter. So they engage in a lot of these contests because space in good locations are limited. They wrestle each other in a forest floor, trying to secure the best perch to call and the best territory to be around. And so these territories are super important because this is basically where they call and advertise to attract females. Females, they have a little bit larger home ranges that contain several males' territory. So they will sample in and around their territories for these different males with different territories and engage in courtship. So basically, when a female comes by, the males will try to woo her. He will call a lot. He will show her around his territory. And essentially, after these hours long of courtship, if the female is satisfied, then the pair will mate and lay a clutch of eggs. So here comes in the second important function of the territory. So the males in the species is responsible for parental care during the egg stage. So the primary goal of these dads is to keep the eggs from drying out because these are eggs laid on terrestrial habitats, so either on leaves or in leaf litters. So drying out is a real big mortality reason. And so the dads usually prevent the water from evaporating by sitting directly on the egg clutches or by peeing directly on them. So he will guard these eggs, perform these duties until the tadpoles are hatched. And then the moms will come back and then transport the tadpoles. So she will do that by picking up the tadpole on her back. And the tadpoles will actually wiggle up her back and then stay there. She will climb the trees and then put these tadpoles in individual nurseries. So these nurseries are little water pools trapped between plant leaves. So these little pools don't have a lot of food. So the moms will actually regularly visit these individual pools and provide the tadpoles with unfertilized eggs as their food source until they metamorphose. So this is actually where the genus name came from, so Ofaga, egg-eating frogs. So with this understanding of what they do, we can kind of think about how colors may come into function in a lot of these different life stages. So a lot of you might have already guessed the first function or the most obvious function I want to talk about is how these colors function as aposematic coloration, or we can call them warning coloration. So the poison frog or the entire family is known for their toxins, as their name suggested. So the name poison duck frogs came from the more poisonous species in this clade. So The tribes in Colombia actually used to coat them on their darts to paralyze their prey. So that's where the name came from. And so essentially the bright coloration that are in a lot of species in this clade function as a bright advertisement of these toxins. So when the potential predators learn to associate the toxins with these bright coloration, these bright coloration is actually acting as a protection to deter the predators from trying to eat them. So that's the biggest function of color in these poison frogs. So by being really bright and conspicuous, they are acting as a big advertisement of I am poisonous, do not eat me. So that's the first function. However, as we go on to see in a lot of examples, color usually does not function in a single context. They are really important in these prey-predator interactions, but they are also, as we gradually found out, really important when individuals of the same species are communicating with each other. So the first function I want to talk about is during male-male competition. So then can I have my first video up, please? All right, thanks. So as I talked about earlier, so these frogs fight a lot. So this is what it looks like when two males are fighting. So they try to wrestle a lot in the forest floor. They don't have teeth or claws. So this is basically a contest of endurance. So the ones that are fighting, that can afford to fight a lot longer, are usually the winner in this situation. So this can happen when one male is trying to take over the territory of another male, or this can happen when two neighboring territorial males are fighting on the edges of their territories. Okay, can we go back to the slides now? Thank you. All right, so I'm interested in whether coloration is important in determining the intensity or the outcome of these male-male competition. So what I did in one of my experiments is I created these robot frogs that are of different colors. So essentially I have 3D printed model frogs and I painted them to match the actual coloration of the frogs. And so this is the apparatus that I designed. So these frogs, they are hooked onto a servo control. So those servo control you found in radio controlled cars. So I can move the frogs around. And I have a speaker that can play the aggressive calls of these frogs and a video recorder. So this is what it looks like in situ. So this is the forest where the frogs are in. So what I did is I took this apparatus to the forest, find a territorial male, set this apparatus down, and then turn on my speaker, turn on the radio control, and then see how the male frog responds to this simulated intrusion. And so a fun fact about this, so this bottom log part where I hide all my electronics and camouflage the whole thing is actually a planter. It worked out really well because it is a planter, it's waterproof, it's durable, and that's like the two most important functions to do in a tropical forest that rain all the time. I just thought it's fun to note. But anyways, I brought these model frogs that are painted different colors to the forest to different populations and test them out with frogs that are of different color. Can we switch to the second video, please, Lynn? Okay, perfect. So as you can see, like there, the frogs are usually super mad at these simulated intrusions. So the little frog in the middle that's attached to the little wheel, that is my robot frog, and the frantic jumping and calling frog that are jumping around, that's the territorial male. So as you can see on the top row, the males are usually super aggressive. They can wrestle these models and trying to pin it down as in an actual fight. But there are also experiments where we see the males that they are responding to these simulated intrusions, but they are not responding to them in a very aggressive way. So they are calling on the side. They might not even jump onto the platform. So they're still aggressive, but just not to the same degree. So we have an array of different degrees of aggressiveness. All right, can we go back to the slide, please? All right, thank you. Okay. So what we did is we visit different populations and then set out to see how color influenced the intensity of these fights. So for example, here we sampled two populations. So one is red and one is blue, which is here on the x-axis. We presented the males with either frog models that are red or frog models that are blue, and then look at their responses. So the y-axis here is proportion males attacking. So out of all my trials, how many of the males actually end up escalating the fight to the highest degree, basically tackling the model? You can think of it as a population level aggressiveness towards certain color. So this is the pattern that we saw. So as you can see, color indeed has an influence on how intense the fight is going to be. So in the red population, the frogs are more aggressive when we present them with a red model. And in the blue population, the frogs are more aggressive when we present them with a blue model. So essentially, there are local differences in how color influence their fight. And in a way that they are responding more to the color that is similar to their own or the color that are seeing more in the population. So here's another example that I want to highlight. So here's another population. So this population, we're actually having two different color types in the same location. So if you walk into the forest in this population, we can find both red frogs and yellow frogs. So with the same setup, we look at how color influence on their fights in this population. So here we can see that color influenced the intensity of their fight as well, but not in exactly the same way. So for the red frog, a red model will elicit a stronger response, a more aggressive response, but it seems like for the yellow male, they don't care that much about the color of the intruder. They're basically equally aggressive to the two models we are presenting them. So color still has an effect on how aggressive how aggressive their fights will be, but not necessarily in a uniform way across all these different color types and across all these different populations. All right, so that's the second function that I want to talk about. After these frogs, after these males secure territory, the next step is for them to find a mate. So for the females that are sampling, they're looking at all these different males that have different territories and potentially have different colors. And it turns out coloration of the male is actually something the females are paying attention to when they're looking for a mate as well. So to see how color is influencing the females choosing their potential mates, we do these experiments called what we call the mate preference assay. So essentially, we're presenting a female a choice between two males that are of different color. So this is a schema from looking from above. So you can think of it as a container. We have two males that are of different colors. They are constrained under transparent plastic containers, and the female is free to jump around this entire arena. So we use the time that the female spent in proximity with each of these males as a proxy of a preference. So usually in a field, the male that the female spent more time with together is more likely to the male that she isn't eventually mated with. Okay, so again, here is an example of when we sample a red population versus a blue population, presented them with a choice of a red male versus a blue male. And the y-axis is the association time that we got from those mate preference assays. So what we saw here is we are seeing again that color is really important for these females in choosing their mates, and kind of interestingly in the similar pattern to the males. So in the red populations, the females are more attracted to a red male, and in the blue population, they are more attracted to a blue male. And so essentially they are attracted to the male that has the same color as their own, or they're attracted to a male that has the same color as their local population. And again, when we look at this population that has two colors with the same setup, this is the pattern that we've got. So essentially, color is still really important. And this time the pattern is symmetrical. So for both red and yellow frog, they are paying attention to the male's coloration. A red female prefers a red male, and a yellow female prefers a yellow male. And so essentially we're seeing that color is influencing so many different things in these little frogs' lives. So, as I talked about in the very beginning, as in other species in the same clade, these colors are really important for the survivals of these frogs because it is essentially preventing them from being eaten by predators. They are acting as an advertisement of the toxins that they carry. And they are also really important in male-male competition. So these males, the males in these species are fighting all the time for a territory, and color is actually a signal that is really important in mediating the strategies and the intensity of these contests. And lastly, as I show you on the last part of the talk, the females, when they are choosing a mate, they are also paying attention to the different coloration of the males. And so thus far, you can kind of guess why looking at color evolution is a really complex problem, because there are all these different selective forces pulling the evolution of color in different directions. Sometimes they're in an opposing direction, sometimes they're in compounded directions in the same direction, or potentially they are interacting in a non-linear way, influencing evolution in an unpredictable way. So one of the things that I'm really interested in is using mathematical models to kind of model different selective forces and kind of predict how the evolution of color will go in the future, and also trying to figure out what might have happened in the past to create all the color we are seeing today. All right, so I will stop here. Thank you all so much for listening. And I also want to thank all my collaborators and mentors that have been part of these projects. And I will happily take any questions. Thank you.
Hi, Yisan.
Hi.
That was really cool. And the froggies are so cute.
Thank you.
I'm trying to do a couple things at the same time. Okay. We have some questions. So the first one is from Deanna. Are there many other frogs or many other species of frogs in the same territories or geographic location?
Yeah, that's a good question. So in terms of poison frogs, there are definitely other poison frog species that are in the same location. And also they have bright colors as well. There are also other species that are not poison frogs. And I'm guessing you asked this question in the interest of knowing whether the frogs are interacting with other species. And mm-hmm. so the answer is yes, they do interact with other species. And sometimes these males are so aggressive, they are chasing other frog species out of their territories as well. And so the color mm-hmm. of those frogs is definitely a big part of, I guess, what shapes their responses to these different coloration. And I know there are some studies looking at how the frogs are responding differently to species that have a similar coloration to their own or species that has a very different coloration. And yeah, and then so, yeah, essentially there's a lot of different patterns, but definitely like it is something that is important to them and shaping their behavior as well. Great question.
Yeah, Kirsten asked, when fighting each other, are they poisonous to each other as well or just to their predators and everyone else?
Great question. So I guess the short answer is no, the poisons will not harm each other. So you can think of it this way. So they sequester their toxins in their skin. So those toxins, so they have to be able to stand those toxins, right? So they have mm-hmm. actually special mechanisms in their skin to prevent the toxins from harming their ion channels, which is mostly how the toxins influence their predators. And yeah, I guess that's my answer. Yeah, they're not influencing each other as much.
Yeah. I think this one's kind of related to the first one, but how large is an individual frog's territory?
That's a great question as well. That also depends on the population and on the density of those frogs. So the density of these frogs in different populations can vary a lot. And a lot, so some of the examples that I saw is that in some populations, if we have, say, 20 meter by 20 meter on quadrant area, like in one of my population, I can get almost 200 frogs out of it. And in some populations, that's like basically one smaller than one frog's territory. So it definitely depends a lot on how dense the population is and how intense the competition is. So the size of the territory will depend on that as well. Yeah.
Cool. So you were showing, well, with function 2 and 3, the competition and like the mating, it looked like the frogs are more responsive to the same color group. Do you know why? Is it, at least for competition, is it just because it's competitive within the same color group? Mm-hmm. And then also, why was like the yellow male, like why was that so different? Why wasn't it yellow to yellow?
Okay, yeah, great question. So that's actually a two-part question. So actually, Lynn, do you mind like sharing my slides again?
Yeah.
So I actually have a spare slide for it. Let's see. I need to share my slide.
Yeah, I see it.
Okay.
Cool.
Yeah. So a question that I also thought about a lot when I discovered that color is important in sexual selection is that how does these color biases came about? So this is a question that I can actually answer. So in one of our experiments, we actually discovered that these biases or like these preferences or aggression biases toward these different color, they're actually not something that is determined by a gene. So they actually acquired it by learning. So what we did is we switched the tadpoles between differently colored parents. And so if you remember these frogs, they raised their tadpoles, the mom raised their tadpoles. And it turns out that it is during this stage when the mom is feeding a tadpole the eggs, the tadpole is remembering the mom's coloration. And when they grow up into a frog, they're using that as a template to develop their biases. For the males, they will be more aggressive to a male that is similar to his mom's color. And for a female, the female is actually preferring the color that is similar to their mom's. So essentially going back to the two examples that I'm looking at, so in the red population and the blue population, they have those biases probably because their mom is that color in that population. And so for the red and yellow population that I talked about later, that one is more complicated because it involves how color is inherited. So basically, if you are a red fox, what are the odds of your mom being a red mom versus what are the odds of your mom being a yellow mom? So the pattern there is more complicated. And then so in addition to that, there are also other factors that can influence on an individual's behavior. So this imprinting is something that we discovered that will happen, but there is also other factors. So for example, if these frogs grow up and interact with frogs of other colors, they might also slightly adjust their preferences or their aggression biases. Mm-hmm. So basically there are a lot of things that could influence their behavioral patterns. We haven't teased out all the factors that are influencing it, but imprinting and learning is definitely a big part of it.
That's so interesting. I would think that the male would not, I would think it wouldn't be rival imprinting. I would have thought like it would have been something similar. So they would have been less aggressive towards someone like a frog of similar color.
Mm-hmm. I think this is another big question that I don't have the answer yet on as well. So basically, you can think of it as two ways. So they might have a certain behavior because it is a byproduct of some other function. So it might not be adaptive. They just have that way. Or they could mm-hmm. have that behavior because it ensures that they are getting a better mate, getting a better territory, or something like that. So whether this behavior is something that is shaped by evolutionary forces to make them adaptive, or whether it is because of a byproduct of some other function, mm-hmm. we don't know yet. Yeah.
Cool. Okay. We have a couple questions that we have little time for, so I want to get through more. Okay. Do the spots or patterns on the frogs also play a role in the competition?
Good question. For competition, I don't know if anyone tested it before in terms of competition, but people have tested that in the context of female choice. So it seems like the pattern doesn't matter that much for the females. The base coloration, so the base coloration of the dorsal skin is actually the most important factor. Hmm. But yeah, I don't know about no male competition. Nobody have tested that before. So potentially.
Maybe someone out there can now.
Yeah.
An idea.
They just paint some little spots.
Yeah. Okay, last question. How does their perception of color differ from ours?
Good question. Yeah, so if they need to respond to the color at all, they need to be able to see it. That's a great question. So their color perception is actually from wavelength 300 to 700 nanometers. So that is on the visible color that we see, the same span as we are, plus a little bit of UV light. So they can actually see, in terms of range, a little more than we do. But in terms of acuity of how well they're distinguishing color, it might not be exactly the same. But what we have is like, we have what we do is, We have measured like how they perceive color by measuring on how the lights influence on how they perceive light, basically. And we can do visual modeling. Sorry, I'm a little rusty on this, but we can do visual modeling basically to kind of visualize the pattern that they are seeing. And so ensure that they are capable of distinguishing among most of the color types that we see there. So on some closer color, like slight different shades of red, they might not be able to tell them apart. But in terms of things like red versus blue or red versus orange, those ones they can tell apart pretty well.
Cool. Thank you so much, Yusan. I learned a lot and I think our viewers did too. So thank you so much for joining us.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Thanks. Up next, we have Erick.
Hello, Hello, everyone. Thanks, Lynn, for the introduction as well. And I'm very excited to be telling you a little bit about butterflies tonight. Can we go? Okay, perfect. So I am Erick Bayala. I'm a grad student at the University of Chicago. I work with butterflies. And today I will be telling you a little bit about how to paint your own butterflies, with what my title says over here. I'm a senior grad student in the lab. I think this first slide kind of brings forward my motivation for this kind of research. I don't need to tell you that animals are super diverse and their magnificent color patterns have cultivated the fascination of people from like artists to scientists all over the world. And this has led scientists to start asking a lot of questions very similar to like, what are these color patterns doing? How are these animals behaving and why they look different? So all of these questions have been explored over the years. However, more recently, there have been other questions that hasn't been that didn't get much attention back then that are gaining a lot more attention. And one of these questions is, how do we go from like a single simple organism to like a fully patterned animal, right? And when I talk about a single cell organism, I'm talking about like how we go from a cell that doesn't even know where the head goes or tails goes, like in the case of a zebra, to a fully patterned zebra that has all these stripes and color patterns. And I think this kind of questions is very deep, not just from the side of color patterns, but also from the side of like, how do you create such an organism is not just beautiful, but also functional? And obviously, we cannot walk a zebra directly into the lab. That's probably not a good idea for many, many other reasons. So we go ahead and pick animals that are good models for answering these kind of questions experimentally. The group of animals that we work with in the lab are butterflies. And butterflies are great for many, many, many reasons. One of them, mainly they were great model system for genetic studies. And also they have been gaining so much attention based on their ecology and their evolution work. So this makes them very well positioned to ask more experimental questions. More specifically, I work with heliconius butterflies, or we're going again back to the tropics like the previous talk. And these are a group of butterflies that are in the neotropics as well. And like I said, let's go to the tropics. And in the tropics, very similar to what we were seeing in the previous talk, these are toxic butterflies and they use their coloration to tell birds, you shouldn't be eating me. And maybe more similar or an example that we're more familiar with is very similar to the monarch case. Here are some examples. You can see this bird that is eating a monarch. And similar to monarchs, these heliconius butterflies are also toxic. And you can see the different stages, what I call of grief. You can see how the bird starts eating the monarchs and eventually say, oh no, I shouldn't be doing this. And then that led to the bird learning its lesson that it shouldn't eat a butterfly that has this coloration pattern. And that is why you have like this beautiful set of colors in the wild to be among many other reasons to tell predators, you shouldn't be eating me. So like I said, these color patterns are very important for the biology of these animals. But however, we don't know much of how do you actually go from like an uncolored version of themselves to a fully colored version of themselves. And in a butterfly, this may sound like, okay, you see the wings, these are the color patterns, but actually we can look closer to them and really tell what is colored about these wings. So here's one example of a beautiful butterfly species. And when we start looking closer, we can see a little bit of a mosaic of color. And when we look even closer, we can see what is really pigmented of a butterfly wing. And what is really pigmented is these scales, these like super tiny structures that are like covering the entire wing. And these scales are choosing a color. It's very similar to a pixel. And once they choose that color, once they are all together, it looks pretty much like a mosaic and creates the color pattern. You can think about this as a like pointillism, right? Where you have like very fine strokes of paints that are very specific colors. But once you go far away from the painting, you can see like the full art. So butterflies just have wings covered with these scales. And what is also another thing that is very interesting is that all these scales, one of their features is that they're choosing a single color. The other feature is that all of them, they're a single cell that you can actually see through the development process. And once I say development, we can actually go a little more deeper than that. And so far, I have been showing you this idea that how you go from an egg to a fully formed butterfly, but we know that this doesn't go exactly this simply, right? We have our metamorphosis stages, caterpillars, we all know about this, the pupation, and then eventually becomes the butterfly. And then the butterfly matures, becomes sexually active, and then reproduce again, and the cycle continues. And this we are very familiar with. However, one thing that we maybe don't know much about is that the process of forming these wings actually starts since the caterpillar. So here I'm using this magical spyglass to see inside this anterior portion of the caterpillar. And you can see this structure called imaginal disc, which is a very fancy word to just say embryological wings. So they're like very, very tiny, super small future butterfly wings. And it's at these stages where the wing starts figuring out what color should I be. As development continues and it goes through pupation, this imaginal disc extends and looks more like the actual future wing, as you can see in the corner. And these wings, as it continues, we can actually track them through development. So this is a butterfly that I took in the lab, removed the cuticle, so you guys can see inside a lot of these colors coming to be on the wing. And I would just let the video play as I talk, but you can see how we go from a single white wing to a more adult-like wing within the pupa. And this butterfly has been, like I said, removed. We removed the cuticle and we put a little bit of plastic so the butterfly feels I'm nice, I'm safe, and we just can keep looking at it through the microscope. I'm just going to play it again real quick so you guys can see it. And we can see these color changes, and we can see how these individual scales are now choosing to become black versus white. Okay, so like I said, we have the opportunity to be able to see this color comes to be, but when it comes to the decision, there has to be something telling you you're going to be this color or that color. And once you see the diversity of heliconius butterflies, you can think about it as, wow, they're very diverse, but I kind of can see certain sets of colors happening here. You definitely can see that like skeleton of black areas on their wings, and you can see how there's some of them that have red, some of them are white, and some of them are yellow. And then you see combination mix and match of these color elements. And this overlays a very awesome principle that people find out with these butterflies is that this beautiful diversity that you find in the wild is actually controlled by very, very few genes. So there's only a small set of genes that are saying, you're going to become black in this part of the wing, you're going to become white in this part of the wing. And this is one of those examples. And I'm just going to walk you through some of the things we can do to learn about these genes. So this is a caterpillar that was taken in the lab, and the wings at the caterpillar stage were removed and then stained for an agent that will tell you where this gene is active. And you can see here in purple, wherever that gene is active, pretty much resembles the future black pattern of the wing. If you're not convinced, we can see it even later in development with a different gene. Here you're looking at a different gene called optics. And this gene at the stage of a pupa, you can see how in green now, wherever this gene is active is going to be those areas that are going to become red. And this starts putting together a map. Well, we now know that the black parts of the wing comes very early during caterpillar stages. And then later during pupation, we can start having by activation of this gene, we can start seeing what areas are going to become red. However, when we go deeper than that, we didn't really knew much about how to make a white butterfly versus a yellow butterfly. And this is more or less where my research started, taking into account what we knew from other genes and asking, do all the genes do the same? Do just they prefigure the future color that you will see in the adult? Going forward to the future, we found that the candidate that makes white or yellow is this gene called Aristolus-1. And this became the most important gene in my PhD. And I'm going to describe this gene with a really nice analogy of like switches. If the switch is on, in other words, the gene is on, you become a white butterfly. If the switch is off, you become a yellow butterfly. And here is just another schematic showing that the gene is on, you become a white butterfly. The gene is off, you see how you become a yellow. And then once we start looking on the adults, I just told you how the switches work, we can also go early, similar to how all these other studies has been done, and see how they look when you go to a pupal stage. And pretty much when the gene is on in a white butterfly, you see this gene active everywhere. And this is already pretty different from what we have seen in other genes. In other genes, we always see them creating this very nice pattern for the future butterfly color pattern. But in this case, we just see it everywhere. And when I say everywhere, one really cool thing we can do is that we can get very close and actually see scales developing and see how these little scales actually become the fully pigmented scales and how they actually are full of this protein activation. And here, like I showed you, these are scales. Imagine now that you are standing on this magical line and then you're going through the wing and then you're going to see how all these scales are just loaded with activation of this Aristoteles 1 protein. As we go deeper into the tissue, you can see how all these scales are loaded with. And this is one of the things we can do in the lab. We can really see where in the wing, not only in the wing, but where are these scales growing and how they are activated or inhibited by certain gene activity. So like I said, we have our switch on. It doesn't really look like a pattern, but then the questions started, wait, how then yellow looks? So when the switch is off in a yellow butterfly, you can see how the pattern kind of comes to be. So if you notice here now how the part, which is in green, how the activation of the gene is just so low in the center of the wing, which makes you decide to be yellow in that part versus the white. So in order to make a white butterfly heliconius wing, you just have this Aristoteles 1 genes thrown everywhere in your wing. But when you want to make a yellow butterfly, you just repress that presence of the gene in the center of the butterfly wing. So this is how it happens in the natural world. And one of the cool things we can do in the lab as well is that we can say, okay, so we know that if it's everywhere it's white, if it's not in some places it's yellow, then we can take advantage of this setup and actually grab our switch and say, let's just grab a hammer and break the switch for a second, break the gene and break the ability of a butterfly to know I'm white. And really cool results, we see how these white butterflies becomes yellow. And if you don't believe me, we can see it very closely how that genetically white butterfly, a butterfly that knows that it's supposed to be white, now develops all these parts of the wings that are yellow. So removing Aristoteles 1 activity, so like just turning off the switch by force, makes this butterfly switch from white to yellow. One thing we can do further from these experiments is that we have these butterflies that have the switch off, that they should be white, so they should have activation of this gene everywhere. But because we switch them off, we should also see some scales early in their development that also are off in their expression. And that's what we see. So if we go there and stain these wings, we actually can see how there's like portions of the wing that are absent with Aristoteles 1 activity. So these portions of the wing will, in the future, become yellow, even when this butterfly should be white. So we pretty much know how it works in the natural world. We confirm our system by doing some experiments. And then from there, we can actually look across several set of butterflies and we can see if this really is the case. So yeah, like here are just a set of like five or six different parts of the wing that also shows this like reduced activity. And this is a white butterfly that thinks in these areas that doesn't have the activity of the gene will become yellow. Okay, so now that we know this, one thing that we can do moving forward is let's actually put all of what we know together and then try to paint some butterflies. Just try to grab these heliconius butterflies and from zero, from like caterpillar stages, explain how we actually make them the different colors they are. like I said, early in their caterpillar stages, they have genes like wingtail that tells them, this is the part where you're going to put the black parts of the wing. You can see them on the proximal part and the distal part of the wing. One thing that can happen is genes like optics at the pupil stage tells you, you are going to become red in the band. And then the butterfly obeys and say, okay, I'm red. And then you have other genes, like in the case of Aristoteles one, that tells you, everywhere on the wing, you won't be taking any yellow. And then you become white. And then something happens that just lowers Aristoteles in the middle of the wing and then says, okay, so now that Aristoteles is not here, you are allowed to become yellow in this middle part of the wing. And that's how, like, in a very simplified model, you actually decide between the different color fates of a heliconius butterfly. With that, I just want to say thank you to everybody in my lab. Thank you for the people in my department, my committee, and everybody that has made this research happen over the years. I also want to say thank you to all like the funding, family, friends, and everybody that has supported me along the way. And a special thank you to the people planning this program tonight. It has been really great to participate in it. And with that, I just want to like say this little on the last 30 seconds that I have left, a little bit of a phrase that kind of like ignited my curiosity about this, which is, will extending the color palette lead researchers to paint a different picture of the development and evolution of color patterns? And this idea is bringing forward that, yes, we are already finding so much more details about how color patterning happens by just adding more and more colors to the spectrum. Thank you.
Hi, Eric. This is so cool. I'm like kind of processing all of those visuals and like, yeah, my mind has been officially boggled. So we do have a lot of questions coming in.
And okay, that's good.
The first is, so you were talking about these knockouts and like artificial, you know, switch flipping in terms of the metaphor. So do we know how environmental factors may play in like later on in the butterfly's life and how they impact these genes switching on and off? Like if a new predator comes into the ecosystem or, you know, other things like that?
Yeah, like definitely there's a lot of environmental factors. And even now that we are just starting to learn how these genes work in their natural sense, this like entire field has exploded also from questions like that. Like, wait, now that we know how the genes work, what happened when it's more sunny outside or stuff like that? So I can tell you, for example, from the side of temperature, like butterflies that are like in places that are a little more cold, they actually change, or they, over time, the color pattern change a little bit to match whatever conditions that they have. It has been shown that it's mainly related with the idea that they can like absorb more heat. Also, you have the case of like pollution on the, like this is one of the most studied cases where you have pollution in the Industrial Revolution and how a moth, not exactly a butterfly, but actually change over time through natural selection to actually be able to be better protected from predators, right? And from there, it just keeps expanding. Like there's in, like reports of beetles that because it's like humid season, actually the water and how the water reflects their color affects how visible they are. And that's like a trade-off between finding mate and actually not being eaten. So there's a lot of these like environmental factors that are affecting color, and you can affect it in so many different levels. You can affect it from the side of like rate of development because it's colder, it's warmer, or you can affect it through like long selection processes and stuff like that.
Yeah, wow. And so this is kind of like leading to another question, which is like, why might some of them lean, some butterflies lean more towards bright and poisonous and don't come near me, while others like, I mean, this is, you know, like you said, moth, not butterfly, but some go more camouflage, like don't look at me.
And butterflies, I'm sorry, I'm biased because I work with them, but they're incredible. There are some butterflies that are being able to solve both problems at the same time. There's butterflies that close their wings and just show their ventral side, which is like nice and opaque and nice to be hidden. But then when they need to like show off a predator who is boss, they just open their wing and show those beautiful set of colors that they have on the other side. So there's this like this link that you can like actually have the independent color patterns on your dorsal versus your ventral side.
Wow. Oh man, independent color patterns on both sides. Yeah, that's so cool. I'm just looking for my next question here. So speaking of multiple colors, so in the development stages, why do colors change so much between caterpillars and butterflies sometimes? Like, you know, with monarchs, they're kind of this, I think the greenish or yellowish, and then the butterflies are so orange. Like,
Yeah, that's a really great question. It depends on their biological like pressures, right? Like you can imagine that when you're a caterpillar, you're just trying to eat, and you want to avoid being eaten because that is continue of you making it to a butterfly. So you want a lot of the times to show all these like greens and browns to be able to camouflage yourself within a tree. Also, there's a lot of caterpillars that are able to camouflage themselves as predators. There's like caterpillars that look like snakes and stuff like that. So there's like differences into like the kind of pressures that you exhibit. And then when you go to a butterfly, you have other things like mating, or you have other things like being able to tell a bird now that you shouldn't be seeing, like eating me because I have these specific colors. So there's definitely levels of pressure, and that kind of determines the color palette that you can have.
Yeah. Oh yeah. That's amazing. Like the pressures literally exist from the time that this caterpillar is like,
Yeah. Pressure is on as soon as they leave the egg or even before.
Yeah. Man, it's just not safe out there. Like you just can't. cool. Yeah. And so it must be difficult to work with such small butterflies because Heliconus, this butterfly is like pretty small, right? Yep. Do you grow your butterflies in the lab from, or yes. I guess you do, but
So we have a greenhouse where we do like all our butterfly rearing with all the permits, and we have like a certain amount of butterflies that are coming from the different places that we need them. And then we also rear in-house so we can get like the embryos and the eggs and all the different stages. But yeah, like definitely working with them, it has been, it's like an initial challenge. For me, I have been working with a set of very small things. I have worked with flies, I have worked with mosquitoes, I have worked with other things that are a little more small. But definitely breathing exercise and like finding a way of just like calming yourself down and having a really nice playlist help.
I like that breathing exercise. Like the frustration.
You learn how to breathe whenever you're trying to work with them.
Yeah. Oh man, that's really good. So okay, I think we have time for just another couple questions. But so pigments are these molecules that hold color. Are all butterflies pigmented specifically, or are there other ways of color that show up?
Yeah. So. That's a great question. Today, I mostly talk about pigmented coloration, right? But as some of you may know, there's also structural coloration. So a lot of these like blues, like very shiny blues or very metallic greens, they are actually created not by a pigment, but the way light is scattered on these scales that I just showed you. What is even like, it's something that is mind-boggling or something like it's so intense that has been found very recently that these same genes that are controlling coloration, they actually may have also a role in controlling the iridescent colors, all those like colors that are more structural. And it's because a lot of these genes is presumed that they are actually affecting how these scales grow. And these can not only affect how pigmentation happens, but can also lead to like alteration of how light bounces out of the scales. So yeah. There's definitely both colors, and there's even butterflies that are transparent. And yeah, like that's just crazy to me.
Transparent. Wow.
Yeah, there's butterflies that have like transparent films on their wings.
Wow. So yeah, they range from colorful to completely transparent. Yeah. Butterflies are amazing. But yeah, I think that's all the questions that we have. But thank you so much.
Thanks
amazing. Yeah.
Thank you.
And we will bring on our next speaker, who's Dr. Simon Griffith, to talk about some birds. And just as a reminder for all you wonderful question askers out there, this one is a pre-recorded one, but stick around. It's going to be great. Super cute birds. Hang in there.
This evening I'm going to talk to you about why the Gouldian finch is so colourful. So I'm an evolutionary biologist, and I study birds, mostly finches, and I study behavior, morphology, genetics, and physiology to try and understand why birds are the way they are. If you're interested in my work, you can go and check my website out. The address is up on the screen there. Two of the biggest questions I've been looking at over the past couple of decades are, how do species evolve and how do traits evolve? And I'm particularly interested in colourful traits like the bill colours you can see on these long-tailed finches here. So firstly, the Gouldian finch comes from a family of very colourful birds. So Gouldians are colourful to some extent because all of their recent ancestors were colourful. So this is a picture from the handbook of all the birds in the world, and you can see the Gouldian finch down in the bottom of this page, and lots of its closest relatives are similarly colourful, maybe not quite so colourful, but they have lots of greens, blues and reds in different parts of their plumage. But what specifically can we learn from the Gouldian finch? Well, the most striking thing about the Gouldian finch and the thing that sets it apart from most other species of bird is that it exhibits this really extreme and obvious polymorphic pattern in wild populations. So here we have a picture of three males of the three different colour morphs, which differ in the colour of their heads. We have yellow, red and black. Now, most birds have variation in colour across a population. So, for example, here are some house finches that you'll be probably familiar with in your local area. And in these birds, we see variation in the expression of colour within a population. So we also have some yellow birds, some orange birds and some more strikingly red birds. But here the colour is distributed along a continuum, and this colour, as shown by studies over in the States, is related to the condition of the different birds. So that's how colour is often expressed in populations of birds. The Gouldian finch is different because here the difference we have in colour is genetically determined, which means these morphs will only express one colour. And the frequency of these morphs is that around 60% of the males in a population have black heads and 40% have red heads. The yellow morph is actually extremely rare. We only encounter about 1 in 3,000 to 5,000 birds in the wild with a yellow head. So for most of the talk today and for most of our research, we've focused on the red and the black. So the head morph has long been known, since 1946, it's been known that the head morph is determined by a sex-linked gene on the Z chromosome, with R, which signals codes for red, being dominant to little r. Now the Z chromosome is equivalent to the X chromosome in humans, which means in birds, the heterogametic sex is females, and males have two copies of the Z chromosome. So if males have two copies of the R allele, the little r allele, then they'll be black-headed. If they have either one or two copies of the big R allele, then they will be red-headed. And females only carry one copy of the gene because they only have one Z chromosome. Now, you don't need to worry too much about the genetics. The point is that the head color is genetically determined. This poses a question which was first formulated by Darwin in his second major book on evolution. If there are two distinct forms of the same species coexisting in an area, then we would normally expect one to outcompete the other. So how do we explain the maintenance of these two forms side by side in wild populations, as you can see here in this photo? That's what a large part of our work has been focused on. So to take you to the wild, the Gouldian finch comes from a spectacular part of Australia, as you can see in these pictures. So it's a bird that lives in the tropical savanna, these open savanna woodlands up in the very northernmost parts of Australia. As you can see, the distribution is right across the top end of Australia, but the largest populations are in the top of Western Australia, the top of the Northern Territory, and then a few very small populations in Queensland here in the east. And again, when you go into these areas, if you're lucky enough to see these birds, you will find the different morphs coexisting side by side. One of the first things we established was that the frequency of the red and the black-headed morphs in populations is relatively consistent over time and space. So the first thing we did was we looked at, we surveyed all of the skins that have been collected by museums over the past 150 odd years. And these skins were found in museums, not only in Australia, but around the world, including actually quite a number in the US. So spatially, we can look at the frequency of morphs in the three different states or territories of Northern Australia. And we see that the numbers or the ratio of the different morphs is extremely consistent. About 60% of the males are black-headed, 40% are red-headed. That consistency is also appears to have been maintained over time. So there's a little bit more scatter in this plot here, but that's largely to do with the low sample sizes in some of these decades. And as you can imagine, museums stopped collecting Gouldian finch skins back in the 1970s. So the consistency suggests that there's an element of competition between these morphs that might be frequency dependent. So to look at this, we took advantage of the many captive Gouldian finches, or the fact that we can easily keep Gouldian finches alive and study them in captivity. So the Gouldian finch, although they've become quite rare in the wild, they're one of the most widely kept birds in captivity. In captivity, we can study dominance in a couple of simple ways. The first way is you simply keep two birds together in a cage over a period of time. And then when you give them food, you can actually score the behavioral supplants of one bird from another. So here in this picture, we have a red bird that's supplanting the black bird that was attempting to get to the food dish. So we can establish a dominance hierarchy over food. Then on the right here in the graph, we look at the probability that the red or the black bird or the yellow bird in this case has dominated the dyad. When a black bird shares a cage with a yellow bird, there are very few dominance interactions, and there's actually a 50-50 chance that the black or the yellow bird will dominate that particular in that particular cage. But when a yellow or a black bird are held with a red bird, the red bird is always the more dominant. So red morphs are more dominant than the other two morphs behaviorally. We can also look at dominance using a vertical dominance hierarchy. So if we establish perches at different heights, a dominant bird, just as in chickens, will always prefer to be on the higher perch. So again, we can easily score which bird is dominant in a particular cage or aviary. And we've also done experimental work where we've experimentally blackened the heads of red-headed birds by using a hair dye. And when we do that, we can actually look at the underlying cause of the dominance. And in these experiments where we've black-treated, for example, red birds, the other bird doesn't see that as a red bird, it sees it as a black bird, but of course the red bird itself knows, intrinsically expresses its dominance behavior. So again, this suggests that red birds are dominant. So if we go back to the wild, why would dominance matter in this situation? So Gouldian finches, like other finches, typically eat grass seeds, and grass seeds are dispersed, obviously not in food dishes, but they're dispersed widely throughout the habitat. So it's unlikely that birds are competing through dominance behavior for access to food. However, in this picture, we can see that gum trees are a relatively limited resource, and the Gouldian is an obligate cavity nester. So they need a cavity in a tree in which to nest. And in the habitat in which the Gouldians live, most of the trees are actually quite young. A tree needs to be between 50 and 100 years old to have developed a cavity large enough for a Gouldian finch to nest in. So we've looked at whether its dominance over nest sites, which is ecologically important in this dominance behavior. Now, nest sites are limited in the wild, but they also vary in quality. So a good nest site, as shown here in the top right, is a nest site which has an enclosed a cavity with a spout and an entrance hole, which is only just large enough for a Gouldian finch to enter. So these two cavities here are high quality because the nest chamber is lower down in the branch or in the trunk of the tree, and this reduces the amount of access to nest predators. By contrast, on the left here, we have a cavity which is of poorer quality. The nest chamber here is actually right at the end here, and you can see that this branch has largely rotten away, which means that nest predators can gain easier access. And we know that there's interference competition for cavity nests, not only from other Gouldian finches, but also from these long-tailed finches, which occur in the same habitat and also like to use cavities. And indeed, here we have a photo of a red-headed male defending its nest cavity, which is here, from this long-tailed finch. So what we find in the wild is that red-headed males get higher quality nests. So we've measured all the cavities in the that were being used and assessed the quality of those cavities. And we know that those cavities are more sought after or higher quality because we also find that red-headed males typically have a lot higher levels of interference in their nests. Now, the consequence of having a good cavity, what makes this important evolutionarily, is that the red males produce more offspring. So on the right hand side here, the red males are producing a higher number of fledged offspring over the breeding season, and that's largely because they're losing fewer nests to nest predators such as snakes and birds and small mammals. So if the red morph is better, why doesn't it outcompete the black morph? So why, when we go to a population and see these birds, and this is a really amazing sight, we're still finding that 60% of all the birds in the population are black-headed. So we've explored maybe a downside to these different morphs by looking at social stress. So here we've held birds in small groups of six males in a cage, but we've varied experimentally, we've varied the frequency of red and black-headed morphs. So we've got some cages which are entirely black, some that are entirely red. This cage here is roughly what we would find in the wild in terms of the ratio, and this cage also has too many red birds. Now, what we find under these conditions is that the more red-headed birds there are in a cage or in a population, the higher levels of corticosterone, which is the stress hormone, those birds will have. As you know yourself, when you're stressed out, that also reduces your immune system, and it's exactly the same for these birds. So this on the y-axis here is a measure of immune response in these birds. And again, red birds in these 100% in these cages that in which all of the birds are red-headed, they have a reduced immune response. Another stressor for birds in the wild, and particularly for these birds, is nutritional stress. So in this monsoonal habitat in which they live, half of the year is very wet and there's lots of grass seed, lots of grass growing, but the other half of the year is dry and the seed stops growing and stops producing, the grass stops growing and stops producing seed. So that means that in half of the year, the birds are having to live on a dry seed diet. So once again, we can experimentally manipulate this in captivity. And when we do so, when we hold birds on a dry seed diet, a low quality diet, we find that red birds, and these are birds that are just held on their own, so we don't have that social stress coming into play, but red birds have a higher level of corticosterone when they're on this low quality diet, whereas blacks seem able to survive on the low quality diet quite nicely. And again, this is hemoglobin concentration. So essentially we're seeing a higher level of anemia in these red birds on a low quality diet. And then that comes through again to the level of offspring mortality. So how well these birds, these different birds can breed. So on a low diet treatment, blackbirds are actually okay and they can raise their offspring, but redbirds lose some of the nestlings that they're trying to raise. So the Gouldian finch actually provides one of the best examples of a theoretical prediction by John Maynard Smith back in the 1970s that we have in this natural population, we have hawks and doves, and they're maintained in a stable evolutionary equilibrium. So in the Gouldian finch, we have red hawks, which have this very aggressive strategy, and we have black doves. And if we get the frequency, or naturally in the wild, when the frequency of those is at the right level, which is around 60% of the birds being black doves and 40% of them being red hawks, then that frequency is maintained over time. If there are too many red hawks in a population, there's too much social stress and there's a negative feedback on those additional red birds. So where did these two morphs come from originally? Well, the biogeography of the Australian monsoonal tropics has been well studied in lots of different species of plant and animal. So what is known is that the habitat they currently live in is across the top end of Australia. And about 2 million years ago, Australia was much drier than it is today. And the habitat in the monsoonal tropics was pushed up into the three tips of the continent. And lots of other plants and animals became trapped in these refugia during this period of aridification. And that's why lots of other birds, such as this long-tailed finch, which coincidentally also comes in three different forms, yellow, red, and black billed, is now found in those three areas of Australia. So for many species like the long-tailed finch, those three different forms, which would have arisen during this period of separation 2 million years ago, they've come back into contact with each other about 500,000 years ago, but they haven't mixed together. Whereas with the Gouldian finch, we believe that they would have been separated at the same time and mutations would have occurred in these populations, which has fixed those different head colours. So we've done some recent work looking at the genome of Gouldian finch, and we've established that there is this big split in a very small part of the genome between the red-headed birds and the black-headed birds. So there's a section of the genome on the Z chromosome. So these are all of the chromosomes across the whole genome of the Gouldian. And on this Z chromosome, we have this one area of around 72,000 base pairs near the follistatin gene. Now, the gene doesn't differ in expression between reds and blacks, but this region is likely to control a number of other genes elsewhere in the genome. And those genes could be contributing to those differences in dominance, immune function, and stress. So in conclusion, we have an understanding of how the two head colors arose. We understand how the red and black birds differ to one another and with respect to their health and behavior. And this has helped us to understand how they can both coexist over time through negative frequency dependence. And this work on the Gouldian also helps us to understand how evolution works on similar traits in other species. At some point in the future, probably one of these morphs will go extinct and we'll be left with either a red-headed bird or a black-headed bird. And we may know nothing. And many other species of bird that are colourful have probably gone through periods in their evolution of having multiple different morphs interacting. I'd like to finish up by acknowledging all the people who have contributed to this work in my research group, and particularly to Mike Fidler and Save the Gouldian Fund, which is established to promote research and work towards the conservation of the Gouldian finch in the wild. And funding was from the Australian Research Council and the two universities in which I've been based during this work. If you have any questions, please don't hesitate to email me, and you can also check out my web. Thank you.
Hi, Simon.
Hi.
That was great. I actually have a few questions, if you don't mind answering.
Sure.
I was curious, where does the red, black, and yellow come from? Because it also showed up in the long-tail finch in the beak.
Yeah, so that's an interesting question. It's one we're doing more work on in those other in that other species, the long-tailed finch. So the difference between the red and the red and the yellow is probably a very simple switch. It's probably a simple mutation which gives rise to the production of a slightly different carotenoid. So a red bird typically will have two different carotenoids, which are pigments. Mm-hmm. And those pigments differ in just the slight structure of a protein. And in some other species, like the zebra finch, a single point mutation can change one of those carotenoids, or it can turn off the production of one of those carotenoids. So you then end up with a more yellow bird. And then the black, so we don't exactly know, but the black is probably masking over the top of the carotenoids. So again, it could just be a single point mutation which is driving the production of a melanin instead of a carotenoid. It's probably a coincidence to some extent that in that other species that lives in exactly the same area, we also find those three different colors. But it's obviously, from an evolutionary point of view, it's easier to go from a red to a yellow than obviously a red to a completely different color, like a, you know, a blue or something like that.
Yeah. Yeah. I also had a couple questions on, like, so do the red ones also produce red offspring?
So it depends on those, on the genetic combinations. So mm-hmm. because the red is dominant, then a red bird, so let's think, a red bird that breeds with a heterozygous male, so a male that carries a copy of both the dominant red gene and the recessive red gene, they can actually produce both, that couple can produce both black offspring and red offspring. But black parents can't produce red offspring.
And then is there like a different dynamic if red ones are more dominant behaviorally, if they've like produced black offspring?
So we haven't looked at that. It's possible. So certainly the red birds that carry just one copy of the red gene, as opposed to those that carry two copies, they don't differ at all. We can't tell mm-hmm. the difference between those. But in terms of the how that affects the dominance, we haven't actually looked at that yet. It's a good question.
Yeah, I'm so curious about all the studies, especially the one where you did a red bird to a red bird, but dyed the hair black or dyed the feathers black.
Yeah, it's a complicated setup. What we're really trying to achieve there is we're trying to just ascertain whether it's something intrinsic about the bird itself or whether it's just its appearance. So obviously, if another bird in a competitive situation looks at a bird and it sees a red head, then it expects it's about to get beaten up. So it might respond differently. So by dyeing them, we're basically asking that question of saying, okay, you now think you're interacting with a black bird, a black-headed bird, so you're not kind of expecting this dominance behavior to happen. But the red bird, of course, it doesn't know that it's dyed its hair. So we haven't given them a mirror, and they probably have no concept of self anyway. Yeah. So we're just kind of looking at, even if other birds aren't responding to you, like they're not kind of worrying about you because you look like a black-headed bird, but do you still feel the need to have that dominance behavior? So those experiments, they're pretty cool.
Yeah, it actually makes me think of, it actually makes me think of like the current like political climate and all of that, like with humans too, just based on like a lot of anti-racism right now. But it's fascinating.
That's absolutely right. Yeah, the appearances can definitely change the way in which you respond to another individual. Right. So it's good to kind of take that out of the equation, which we can do nicely in these experiments.
Yeah. I'd love to see how the rest of that goes. But this is cool. I think that's all I have. But thanks so much, Simon. This was fun. Okay. Hi.
Hello.
outfit change. Thank you, everyone, for tuning in. And thanks, Yusan, Eric, and Simon for being part of Night School tonight. For those of you that didn't catch this in the beginning, we are moving to monthly starting today. So first Thursdays of every month, please join us. I just want to give a special thank you to everyone who's been with us for the last year plus, over 50 programs. Thank you so much for all the weekly love. And I just want to give a quick shout out to some regulars that Christina and I and the rest of the Nightlife team have noticed. So Ignite the Spark Within, all caps. Sharon, Deanna, Orle and Friends, Tom, Mako, and then also everyone who's been watching that doesn't comment. We appreciate you so much. So thank you everyone for sticking with us. Next month, August 5th, we'll be taking a trip to the East Coast and specifically Cape Cod. Every year, sea turtles have been moving up the coast due to warmer temperatures during the summer months. But as temperatures drop, they are all often stranded in what locals call the deadly bucket. So join us as we learn from some of the people saving and flying hundreds of sea turtles back to safety.
Yeah, and to tune into that, make sure you don't miss it so you can subscribe. I think it's below for you, probably, if you're on YouTube. Or, you know, like the page, turn on your notifications, do all the things so you can be notified on that first Thursday of the next month. We will be back with more programs.
Join our email list, subscribe. I don't know what else. But or come in person. We'll be there.
Come in person.
Hopefully we'll see you in a month.
Thanks, everyone. Take care.
Thanks.